I love Toy Story. It was one of the first animated movies that I saw as a kid, and despite the fact that I saw it nearly 5 years after its initial release, the movie won both my immediate and eternal admiration for its brilliant storytelling, beautiful animation, and creative and imaginary world building. However, we're not talking about Toy Story today, as in 1996, a budget version was made by none other than Dingo Pictures. Don't worry though, it's more or less the same thing as Toy Story. If Toy Story was written by a bunch of illegal immigrants who couldn't speak English very well, was animated by a bunch of dyspraxics, acted out by a bunch of raging alcoholics who were relapsing, and the master copy was puked on before it was sent out. Now, you're probably going to be saying, "Oh, you dumb twat, this is a movie, not a game. You meant to cover this on your other show about TV shows and films."
Au contraire, my foul-mouthed naysaying friend. I'm actually playing a PlayStation 2 game today.
Yep, it's another one of those atheism-inducing travesties of film burnt onto a CD and labelled as a PlayStation 2 game. This is our third Dingo Pictures game. Huzzah! Considering that it's been 20 episodes since I last covered a Phoenix game of this caliber, I decided to play another one of those god-awful fucking movie Phoenix games, made by our friends, the Code Monkeys.
Wait, why do I know that name?
Holy shit, they made that fucking awful Simpsons skateboarding game, and that Shrek game I've always wanted to play on the PS1. Believe it or not, this wasn't even close to the end of their lifespan. They made that Simpsons skateboarding game around the time of releasing these shitty Phoenix game movie ports, and were still in business until 2011. I don't know how that's possible. I think they should have been arrested for war crimes years before that. But considering that their attempt at a licensed PS2 game was the worst skateboarding game ever made, it's actually mighty impressive that it lasted a decade, and even outlives Phoenix Games themselves. The movie starts off with this notable stock music from Dingo Pictures' seemingly bottomless pit of stock assets. You might wonder why they dedicate around 30 seconds to showing off this wank crayon drawing of a house that looked like it was drawn by a child, but you're forgetting that Dingo Pictures just love to waste their runtime. This is more or less an excuse for them to waste 30 seconds without actually doing anything. One Lord of the Rings trilogy later, we cut to Jesus fucking Christ! That Jack in the Box is fucking terrifying!
You'll be glad to know that this Hellspawn is a main character, so you're gonna have plenty of opportunity to look at his mind-numbingly terrifying expression.
Only 2 more hours, Mont Pino the Ragdoll.
His name's Penis the Ragdoll. Ew!
Yes, I know his name's Pino or something, but in truth, I think Penis is a much more fitting name because, well, his only character trait is him being a massive cock to begin with, so it ties in with that pretty well.
Sighed the other toys. Only 2 more hours. What did he say? Asked Pronto the telephone. He was a little deaf, and one always had to tell him things twice.
That's not funny, you piece of shit! Why did Dingo characters love laughing at other people's afflictions? And why is deafness so funny to these fucking idiots?
Quasimodo may be a monster, but no one can ring the bells as beautifully as him.
Is it true? He's gone deaf from the noise.
Yes, that's true. But one handicap more or less won't make a difference to him.
It's only 2 more hours before the little boy comes home from kindergarten, explained Cuddly the Cushion. Oh my goodness, sighed Pronto as well. Only 2 more hours.
Only 2 more hours of explaining the same shit over and over again before we have to explain something else over and over again.
Oh, come on, you're all acting as if it was the end of the world. It's only the little boy's birthday, said Jumping Jack.
I don't know, talk any faster and you could create a resonance cascade that rips the fabric of reality apart and destroys life as we know it, said Jumping Jack.
Come on, skateboard. Come on. Let's ride another round. I don't want to, said Skateboard. What's wrong? Asked Pronto again. Roller the Skateboard doesn't want to do a round with Jumping Jack, explained Cuddly the Cushion.
Oh, for the love of fuck! Stop explaining shit and move on!
Oh, you don't say, said Pronto. And you? What's up with you, Pino? Won't you at least play with me? Leave me alone, said Pino.
Take the fucking hint, you fucked up Ace Lightning reject! Nobody likes you! Fuck off!
Just look at this big sad heap. Can't get over the fact that your Daisy's favorite toy are over, jibed Jumping Jack. Game over, peeped Charlie the Chip. What does he mean? Asked Pronto. Game over means you finished the game, translated Cuddly the Cushion.
Well, you wouldn't know that from playing this fucking game.
Charlie Chip is right for once. It really is game over for Pino. He'll soon end up in the garbage. Now stop annoying him. It's going to be different for all of us after today, not just for Pino.
At this point, they make it transparent that it's the same dynamic as Toy Story, which is fine for a rip-off. I mean, it is a rip-off after all. I mean, I can't expect too much from it. But this is a rip-off with shittier animation, virtually no plot, and it looks like one guy is literally voicing everyone in this film. This must be one of those really shit early Dingo Pictures movies.
Yes, believe it or not, these things actually do improve with age. The original ones were like these still shot picture book things that looked a little better actually, because they were properly drawn images instead of this crap. But they didn't have any animation whatsoever. Later on, they actually had more than one voice actor and even attempted musical numbers. But sadly, we're not quite there yet.
In the beginning, they were basically audio books with slightly moving pictures over them. They're movies, in massive sarcasm quotes. Like Nice Cats are great examples of this, as that's the same thing, basically. I also want to point out that in 3 minutes of a 33-minute long cartoon, nobody has done anything but just explain the same shit over and over again. I swear, a third of this thing's runtime is dedicated to explaining shit, the next third is dedicated to reiterating what was explained in the first set of explanations, and the third is just pointless shit like overly long establishing shots and walk cycles.
I don't understand different. What do you mean by different? That's the little boy's birthday, so we'll be getting a new toy, Cuddly explained patiently. And then the little boy will only play with his new toy, and we'll be left lying in the corner, feared Skateboard.
Why the fuck did Nighty's hip dog get reincarnated into a skateboard?
Why should it be a new toy? Maybe the boy will get something quite different. New shoes, or new trousers, or something practical, mused the telephone. Rubbish! His aunt will give him something like that. She has no imagination. But his parents will give him something to play with, explained Jumping Jack. But why should they when he has us? Said the building blocks. He doesn't need any new toys. Exactly. And he especially has me, said Pino. I mean, when I really think about it, I just can't believe that he'd like a new toy better than me. After all, he can't go to sleep without me.
Why? Look at you. You're his dad's old wank sock, for fuck's sake. Is this kid special? Wait, why the fuck does he have a rake in his bedroom?
You're the only one who believes that. He won't even look at you anymore, and his mother will use the opportunity to throw you away. She always said that you were dirty and unhygienic.
She said that you're dirty and unhygienic because you're literally a wank sock. Also, you probably spilt some splooge over the poor kid, which is why he won't look at you anymore.
Game over. Game over.
That's it, man. Game over, man. It's game over.
The doorbell rang penetratingly.
The doorbell rang penetrating me?
I swear that's what I heard the first time I saw this thing. I even had to go back over it again just to listen a second time to make sure that that is not what was said. Believe it or not, that wouldn't even be the worst thing that's ever been said in one of these cartoons.
There he is, whispered Pino.
Yeah, narrator. You don't have to whisper as well, you cock.
The little boy didn't come near the nursery. He immediately ran into the living room where the birthday table was laid, and his parents were waiting for him.
What the fuck is this perspective? Never mind.
The toys also crept quietly into the living room.
Jesus fuck, these walk cycles! Ugh.
Uh-oh, they said.
Uh-oh is right. That animation is fucking dreadful.
So many presents that could just be things to wear in them. That big package over there, the one with the bow, looks very much like a toy.
My sentiments exactly.
That thing's really ugly, cried Skateboard.
Normally I'd say something like, don't judge, or something along those lines. But no, not gonna. That baby is fuck ugly. Not as ugly as this fucking Death Note reject, or this used up old dick warmer, but still an ugly fucker if I ever saw one.
There's no way he could love that dog.
Exclaimed Penis as he pulled the ugliest face imaginable just to prove himself wrong.
There's no way of knowing exactly, but there's one thing I can tell you. That thing looks as if it's really going to get on our nerves, added Cuddly the Cushion. Prot had been holding his receiver out at arm's length so as not to miss anything. Get on our nerves? You mean even more than Jumping Jack?
Oh, bitch!
Yasta gasped, and the new toy promptly started screaming.
That shaking head thing for crying was something that Dingo used to do back in their Hunchback days, and somehow this is the most disgusting creature that's done it.
So loud that even Jumping Jack, he couldn't stand it.
Oh well, at least they know how the audience feels.
The boy finally sat down to cocoa and cake. The toys returned to the nursery. End the alarm, said Charlie Chip. That little monster won't be of any danger to us. His friends nodded relieved, and for the first time that day, their good spirits rose and they started to play. Pino helped the building blocks to build a wonderful tower. As they finished, the new toy came into the room.
So the building blocks are Loco Roco. Okay.
I'm Pamba. Which of you is Pino?
She shrieked in that horrible baby voice.
If it's so horrible, why are you inflicting it on us, Mr. Narrator?
Everyone looked at Pino.
It's you! Your days as favourite toys are done. The little boy's only going to worry about me from now on.
Pampa started shrieking. Shut up, said Jumping Jack, turning on her.
What the fuck was any of that? Do you think they could have spoken clearly instead of speaking really hurriedly and then leaving that 3-second pause in there?
Game over, said Charlie Chip.
Will you stop with the game over thing? I'm gonna pull your fucking batteries out and put them in a vibrator, you stupid Avon catalog game system fuck!
Game over nothing, laughed Pampa. I'm just getting started!
And then knocked the tower over.
Justice!
Oh, ow, cried the building blocks.
So, they had a second group of actors,
but decided to use them on the building blocks instead of the main characters.
Oh,
that stupid thing destroyed my tower, said Pino.
Oh, yeah, don't worry about us. Worry about your stupid fucking tower, you Raggedy Ann hooker piece of shit.
Things could get hot around here. Skateboard started scolding.
The fuck are you on about? Skateboard started scolding. That's the weird pillow gnome fuck. And how is that scolding? He's commenting on the situation, not telling anyone to do anything.
You stop annoying us at once, or else you're gonna get it from us, I'm telling you.
I'm a baby, and babies are allowed to do anything. Just you wait and see.
At that moment, the little boy came into the nursery because even on birthdays, there's a time to go to bed.
Yeah, 2 in the afternoon, apparently.
He heard his new toy crying and immediately picked it up.
What's wrong with him? Why are his legs like that? Why is he a fully grown man? Why does he have grey hair? Is he actually some weirdo who likes to pretend that he's a kid? It's the only thing I can think of here that makes sense.
Nah, what did I tell you?
Grinned Pamper at Pino triumphantly.
If I was in your position, I'd disappear of my own free will before they threw me out.
Without even looking at Pino, his old favourite doll, the little boy took Pamper with him to bed.
After dyeing his hair blonde and bleaching his skin, of course.
Pino was left weeping quietly on his own.
He didn't even look at me. Ever since I've lived here, I've been allowed to sleep with him every night and now.
His friends would have loved to join him, but Cuddly Cushion thought it would be better to sympathize with him.
Well, B-Tech Atari Link seems happy about Penis's misfortune.
I have an idea, called Charlie Chip. Let's look in my game instructions on how to defeat an enemy.
You is the Pope of Fools.
We don't need any game instructions for that, exclaimed the building blocks. We'll throw ourselves at its head, all of us at once. And if that doesn't work, I'll ride over it, added Skateboard. I could cut it open with my jumping spring, grinned Jumping Jack happily.
Ah, my favourite part of any kid's film. The scene where they all plan to assault, disembowel, garrote, and hopefully murder the new guy.
Or I'll throttle it with my telephone cord.
Stop this now, scolded Cuddly. You've all gone crazy. No, first thing in the morning we'll talk to Pamper. He's bound to listen to reason. The toys looked rather skeptical. Pity, murmured Jumping Jack.
I was looking forward to feasting on his entrails after disemboweling him, Jumping Jack explained.
Pino wasn't convinced either. His tears just couldn't stop falling. But the toys were tired after all the sympathizing, and one by one they fell asleep, except for Pino. He felt deserted. That baby's right. No one loves me anymore.
I'm just a nuisance. They probably all wish I was no longer here.
Pino decided to run away and never return.
Wait, hold the fuck? They're all literally on your side. They just said that they wanted to help you murder the dumb fuck baby.
So he packed his bundle and scrambled out of the window. It was dark outside. Everyone was asleep. Pino was all alone in the street.
Now the others will see how they do without me. The little boy will also see what taking that awful thing to bed will bring him. That eternal noise will get on his nerves.
But then there won't be Pino there anymore when he can't sleep or is afraid of the dark.
Yes, that's just how it'll be.
This is starting to sound a lot more like a lover's spat than a story about toys at this point.
Oi! Is that toy out after curfew? Motherfucker, he's stealing shit! Get him!
Seriously though, why are the police after him? Did they have a no toys out after dark rule or something?
I don't know what mental hospital they broke into to record those two wheelie bins laughing sound effects, but they probably shouldn't be getting their audio this way. Also, why did this get the dramatic dingo sting when it's not remotely dramatic? It's more stupid than anything.
Oh, that's mean to throw away a banana peel like that.
Hey, look, Mumph.
Giggled Mumph.
I think he's just right for us, from the look of him. He should have landed here ages ago.
Shall we snatch him, asked Mumph.
Pino stared in shock.
Stop it! I've done nothing to you!
The streetlight leaned forward curiously to see what was happening.
What the fuck? Streetlights are sentient now! I know that the garbage cans didn't give me much trouble, but how the fuck does this even work? At least with Toy Story, things with a face could talk and come to life. This makes no fucking sense whatsoever. Does that mean like the carpet's alive as well, or does that get a pass? Does the lamp bend metal in order to move? Like, what the shit is any of this?
Do you want to get him or I? Mumph asked her brother. As much as I hate to say so, I'd love to have him. But I'm only allowed to take recyclable garbage, and this one could definitely not be used again. He belongs to you, sister, said Mumph, generously.
Sister? I guess she was recycled into a man? Or however that shit works?
Okay then, come along, little one. Up into the garbage can and off to the garbage disposal, laughed Mumph. Now don't carry on like that, it's very comfortable up here with us, tempted Mumph.
That about sums it up, yeah.
And it smells delightful.
Pino paralyzed with shock as he heard the garbage cans talking.
What does he even have to be afraid of? They literally have to convince him to let them eat him. They're the worst predators in history.
And now the rats were also coming closer, while considering whether to start nibbling at him at once or to play a bit of cat and mouse with him.
Again, Penis has nothing to worry about because these rats are too fucking lazy to go after him. They might as well be inanimate trash cans for all it's worth.
Mind you, he is stupid enough to fall for their wily ways, so I guess he has something to be worried about.
The streetlight took pity on poor Pino.
The streetlight took so much pity on poor Penis that he replayed his only bit of animation for him just to cheer him up. Scene continuity be damned.
Hurry up, little one, before the rats get their teeth and stuck into you, she called to him. Pino woke from his paralyzed fear, up and ran as fast as his legs would carry him. In his fright, he forgot his bundle. On and on, without turning around, till his legs couldn't carry him anymore.
Gee whiz, where'll I land it up, he sobbed,
and looked around him.
Oh, he ended up in Guy Bridge. You've really fucked up this time, Penis.
They were all right. I really do belong in the garbage.
Pino was afraid. Because he'd left his bundle behind, he had nothing to eat or drink. And his stomach's growling got louder and louder, which made things even worse.
He doesn't even have a stomach. He's full of stuffing and cum. He doesn't even need to eat the dumb shit. Wait, does he shit? How does that work? What?
I want to go home. I want to go back to Cuddly and Pronto and Rollo and Charlie Chip and Jumping Jack.
Desperate, he fell onto an old and dilapidated couch that had been put out.
If I'd only stayed home, even if the little boy didn't love me as much as before.
But the others could still love me. He slowly cried himself to sleep.
If it took you this long to figure that out, you deserve to be homeless, you piece of shit.
This morning, the toys were all rubbing their sleepy eyes. An unknown noise had woken them. Oh, yes, yesterday had been the little boy's birthday and a new toy had come to join them. You can hear that.
We don't need a recap almost two-thirds into the fucking movie, you piece of shit narrator.
Yep, we're on the second act. Sure as fuck feels like it.
Can't you at least shut up in the early morning, said Rollo emphatically.
You still haven't caught on. Babies are allowed to cry whenever they want to.
Grinned Pamper.
Actually, that's not true. Babies can only communicate through crying because they can't speak yet. When they can speak, they're discouraged from crying. Wait, why the fuck am I explaining this? It's obviously too late for these arseholes.
You're not crying, you're screaming, Mon Pronto. You've even woken me, and I'm relatively hard of hearing. You've got a lot to learn, Pamper, interceded Cuddly. You belong to us now, whether we like it or not. We have to be considerate of one another.
I don't have to be considerate to anyone. If I complain about you, the little boy, he'll throw you all out, said Pamper.
Wait, what? The toys talk to their owners?
Do you people understand the basic concept of the Toy Story premise? Do you get any of it at all?
So what? Does the little boy actually tell them who he's taking to bed? Do they get any say in it? Can't they just solve everything wrong with this movie by explaining the situation to him?
Fuck it. I don't care.
The others all moaned. Where is Pino? All started looking around. When I feel bad, I creep into my box, and then I close the lid. But as Pino doesn't have a box, maybe he's crept under the bed. Roller surfed under the bed. He's not there. Hey, you there. Is Pino with you in your box? Jumping Jack asked the building blocks. No, he's not here with us either, they answered. His bundle's gone, said a shocked Charlie Chip. Oh, I think he's run away.
A good thing, too. He disturbed me all night long with his crying.
You can't say shit, Mr. I Cry for Attention.
That's a joke coming from you, said Pronto. He's only thinly dressed. He'll catch cold, and apart from that, he doesn't know anyone out there, added a troubled Cuddly. Now take it slow. Maybe he's hidden himself to make us worry. We should wait a little longer. But waiting was harder than the toys could have imagined, and apart from that, Pamper did not stop getting on their nerves.
That's enough. Be quiet, you little backbiter, Cuddly went for Pamper furiously, and the Cuddly cushion was seldom angry. I've had it, said Roller finally. I can't stand it anymore, just sitting around. I'm going to go out and find Pino.
Yes, you're right. We have to find him. The others all agreed.
Hey, Charlie Chip, you have experience with chases and adventures, etc. You take over the lead.
Charlie Chip was flattered. He could finally show the others what was in him.
Glad to, he said. I know all the traps we could fall into on the way, and all the tricks to escape from a dangerous situation.
I also know how to drag out a scene with animation loops.
Charlie Chip switched himself on.
He switched himself on? How the fuck does that work? Does that mean he's been sentient this whole time?
Please don't hurt me. Actually use you every once in a while.
All right, said Cuddly. Then off you go. I'll stay here in case Pino shows up. But Pronto must go with you, so we can keep in contact.
I have to go along as well. After all, I'm the only one who can scare those criminals that are holding Pino, so...
Out of all these idiotic roles that these toys have assigned themselves, such as the phone trying to work as an actual phone and the Game Boy trying to be the guide, the Jack in the Box is the only one who would actually succeed in his job of scaring the living fuck out of people.
And what about me, ass Pamper?
You stay here.
Was he about to break into song there?
You go kill yourself!
They all cried simultaneously.
Your screaming is the last thing we need.
Anyway, you're happy that Pino disappeared. You said so yourself.
But then I'm here all alone, with no one to play with me,
complained Pamper. What you really mean is no one to annoy. No. You stay here. Pamper started howling. But the toys just ignored it. Cuddly the cushion accompanied his friends to the front door. Hop on, commanded Roller. Pronto, Charlie Chip, and Jumpy Jack jumped on, and took their places. Be careful, called Cuddly, as the train took off.
Yes. Train. This is really not just a skateboard with some shit piled on top of it. So these jackasses roll around to the tune of the Peter Gunn theme until they reach the idiot trash cans from earlier. I don't even know how these two survive, since their stomachs get emptied as soon as they're filled, like they're supermodels or something. But then I remember that this is a movie about a 50-year-old man that sleeps with a little girl's doll and his dad's old cum rag, so I guess anything's possible. They then debate with themselves if they should question the only witnesses of what went down last night before eventually asking them.
There! That's 2 minutes of movie I've saved you from. You're welcome.
Hey, you there. Have you seen Pino?
Pino? Who could that be? Said Mumph. Well, he's a rather tatty ragdoll. Yeah.
Is that skateboard high? Why the fuck would these two know Penis by his name? The Idiot Express don't even know if they saw him yet.
With a striped cap? Asked Mumph. Yes, that's him, cried the excited toys. Pino. Pino's his name, laughed the garbage cans. We found him. That makes 867 points, chirped Charlie Chip.
Apparently there's something funny about Penis's name.
They're really looking for him. Stop that and tell us where he went to, scolded a jumping jack who was beginning to lose patience. But the garbage cans just kept laughing. Once they start, it's hard to stop them, grinned a rat who had been observing everything. And you? Maybe you know where Pino has gone, asked Roller. No idea, said the rat. Really, I've no idea. He ran away from us.
Man, ever since Rasputin blew himself up like a fucking idiot, Fat Shoulder Rat's life has gone straight downhill. Poor little guy.
The toys went right, but there was no Pino to be found.
Which is why they look so goddamn happy about it. Also, bit late in the game to be bringing this up, but what's the point in a skateboard where one end of it's bent?
Pino slowly awoke. Pino rubbed his eyes.
Oh, so it's all right for Penis then. The attention-seeking little wank sock.
Oh, wow. Did I have a bad dream last night? Oh, what happened was...
I was on a train full of Gordon Freemans.
Hey, where are you all? He looked around. He was sitting on an old sofa in a junkyard. He hadn't dreamt it. It was all real. And the fear came back with the memory. Oh, my goodness, what a pile of misery we have here.
Funny, that's just what I was about to say about this fucking movie.
He heard the sudden racket and looked up in fright. Actually, this is my apartment. Not very polite of you to stay here overnight without knocking and asking, scolded the garden dwarf.
One, that's a junkyard, not an apartment. And two, you don't own it, you stupid gnome fuck. Legally, it has to be yours for it to be your property. Dickhead.
Pino started crying. Now, don't start crying.
You sound like a little girl and it creeps the fuck out of me. It brings back some horrible memories of the last guest I had here.
I can imagine what happened. Come on, tell me about it. Then you'll feel better. You'll see. By the way, my name is Michel.
Good. At least he has a name to give to the police after he's violently fucked in this junkyard.
And so Pina told him of his friends and the birthday and the new toy.
Remind me why I should give a shit. This guy's basically the same character as that old pervert pig from Janice the Little Pig. I'm not even kidding, they even have the same voice actor and everything. He's just what Toy Story needed to make it a true masterpiece.
No, he's not!
Slowly, Pino stopped sobbing and followed Michelle around.
Pfft, what the fuck's wrong with their faces? Seriously, could these two look any more stupid during their walk cycles? didn't even get the best cards dealt to them in life to begin with, and now they're just trying to look stupid and ugly.
But to live here? Forever? That was something he just couldn't imagine. This may be all right for you, he said to Michelle. You're used to living in the open.
But I'm too good to live in such a shithole. You pompous son of a whore.
In the meantime, Pino's friends were more and more desperate. They had searched the whole area, but found no Pino.
Game over.
What do you mean, game over? Asked Roller.
Just that. We've lost. Game over. The end.
Oh, good. Does that mean this thing's over and I can actually play something good now?
Oh, of course not. This dumb shit robot was just looking for an excuse to say a shit catchphrase that'll never catch on. Also, bit of a nitpick, but out of all of the colours that you can turn into, why did you have to pick pink? Now you can't tell between the screen and your body, you stupid Game Gear piece of shit.
I'll call home, said Pronto. Maybe Pino just hid away and Cuddly has found him.
Yes, baby, what are you wearing? Ooh, you naughty bitch, you. How wide are those legs of yours? Ah, shit, I got another call. Talk later, baby. What?
No, just as you've asked. We presume that he's not with you either. No, answered Cuddly sadly. He's not here. Oh dear, said Pronto. What do you want to do now? Well, it looks like we'll have to break off the search. It'll be dark soon, said Pronto wearily. Cuddly sadly hung up the receiver. They didn't
find him?
Asked Pamper. Cuddly shook his head.
And now you want to make me feel guilty?
Leave me alone.
So the losers make their way back home past the age-old graffiti that's existed since Captain Crunchbone founded this asinine town back in... whenever. As luck would have it, Rasputin's stupid fat rat saves the day by informing them that the old wank sock has ended up going to the dump where he fucking belongs.
Pino! Screamed Jumping Jack loudly and excitedly.
Pino! Pino!
Oh, shit, looks like I'll have to go out there and take care of that rabble again.
If I'm not mistaken, somebody's calling you, said Michelin. Calling me? Asked Pina. No, that can't be. Who would be calling me?
Pino! Pino!
Pino! Pino! Pino! Pino!
Oh god, not those wankers. I thought that the one silver lining of this was that I got away from them.
Pino! Pino!
Pino!
Jumping Jack, Roller, Pronto,
Charlie, Chip, how did you all get here?
Oh, this is great. Now don't start crying again, said Michel, obviously touched.
What the shit is that? Oh look, Albert Wesker's joining in on the celebrations too. Blow me.
Do you live here now?
Asked Charlie Chip. Looks pretty interesting, stated Jumping Jack, whose head was at the highest extension so that he could check out the area.
You could have ended up somewhere worse.
Does that mean that you think I should stay here? Do you really don't want me to come back with you? Huh? Oh, but of course, naturally we do. Do you still want to? They asked. If I'm still allowed. But of course, said Charlie Chip happily. That's why we came looking for you. But what about Pamper? Asked Pronto.
I'll punch him in the mouth if he screams again or annoys Pino, promised Jumping Jack.
With what hands?
Well, at least after this long adventure, they all learnt something about themselves. That they all hate Pamper. You know, like they knew at the beginning of the fucking story when they tried to murder him?
So the idiot toys make their way home via montage that lasts nearly 2 minutes. They reunite on 50-year-old boy's porch, and Penis celebrates by giving the old pillow a blowjob, and Pampa learns the true meaning of Christmas or something. I don't fucking care.
An unusually quiet voice. Leave Pino alone, Jumping Jack spat at him immediately. You know what? Pino said generously to his friends. It's not really Pampa's fault that the little boy takes him to bed with him.
There's a great line to take out of context. So the movie ends with a load of obnoxious sound effects, the characters don't change, and the only thing we have to hope for is that they all get thrown in a dumpster when little boy goes to college, or an old people's home, in Toy Story 3. Maybe they'll get incinerated as well.
It belongs on a great big fire! Yeah.
Welche natürliche Bäppchen.